Hey, hi everyone. So if you can listen to me, please ping me on chat so that I can start. Yeah, so I think first of all I will introduce myself. So myself, Priyesh Tiwari. I have around 7 years of experience in IT field. I worked on .NET technologies and React and Angular also, and sometime on Node.js and on Java also in bits and pieces. So yeah, you can start asking questions or whatever queries you guys are having. Guys, I'm expecting questions or queries. Yeah. So first of all, I think Ashwini has posted a question. So basically, Ashwini's question is, can you please explain Flexbox concept? Yeah. So Ashwin, Flexbox is something to basically lay out elements. This is something which we use to lay out divs onto the page. What happens, for example, earlier we have that float design where means laying out the design was not that easy. We basically used to have float left and then clear something if you want to move to next row. So now I think in newer CS framework which browser is supporting now, they have this flexbox concept. I think by following this flexbox, I think you can easily lay out your element. Basically, it's a one-dimensional layout thing. There is, I think, one new other framework which I think browser are introducing. It's a grid layout. So it is a two-dimensional layout. Since you have asked only question on flexbox, so basically flexbox is a one-dimensional layout to lay out your elements onto the page. Basically, something like that. You have a div, a container in which you basically give display flex, and then inside div you have multiple divs in which basically those divs are called as a flex items. So now basically what happens, those divs, you will find that when you put those markup into HTML and when you render it in your browser, you will find that those are automatically getting horizontally laid out. So there are a few properties of flexbox which you have to learn over net, how to lay the flexbox in the column order, how to lay the flexbox. By default, it automatically lay itself in a horizontal way, but there are certain tricks you can apply to basically do other cool sort of stuff very easily with flexbox concept. While if you try to do the same thing using old school of designing layout, it will be a bit tedious. But I think with this new framework flexbox and the grid layout, the laying out component into the HTML page is very easy. I think there are a lot of tutorials available on the net. I think flexbox is a pretty I think small set of classes present, like align item, align self, flex direction, flex rollo, flex basic, flex shrink. You just need to practice in the HTML, you will get the grasp of this concept. So I think hopefully it might answer your question. So I think, yeah. So Sachin has asked the question, how to import observable in Angular 6. I think Sachin, I think you can easily get this answer on that. Okay, what I can do, I can find this for you all on the net, but I think you can find this answer. Means it's a I think general ES6 syntax. You can do something like import observable from rx.js, so something like that. Means it, you can easily find over the net, and then you have the observables available. For example, there are a lot of filter, there are a lot of operator available in rx.js, like which operator you want to go. For example, you want to have an observable, key observable, you want to have flat, map, there are a lot of operators applied by RxJS. Subscription, behavior, subject, or whatever you want to have. You can easily import something like this, the way ES6 works. Import, destructure that thing from RxJS and then import your whatever you want to import, subject, behavior subject, and then call that somewhere into your code. So I don't think that's a big thing. Just search over the net, you will get there. I think syntax will mostly be the same what I said. So I'm moving to next question. Okay, I'm coming to questions. So now Vinay has asked the question. I have a problem in code which is not running properly. If I provide my GitHub, can you help me with that? Yeah, sure, Ashwin. You can submit, and I think that to advisor there. I can look at the queries which guys have asked to me, and I surely I can ping there. Okay, Sachin has again asked why observables. So Sachin, observable is basically if you know about observer pattern. I think if you know programming. So basically there are various ways to do things. So observable basically is a sort of a streaming sort of a library, reactive programming. If you heard of a reactive programming concept, by reactive programming, I mean that there's a stream of data coming and you want to handle those stream of data, and a stream of data can be asynchronous also. It's not always that it's a synchronous data. It can be asynchronous also, and it can come from various sources like click of the button, like any asynchronous event happening, like you are reading from some network stuff, so anywhere. So basically now you want to handle those data in a very concise way, or in a functional programming way. Basically RxJS, the idea of RxJS is more evolved from functional programming. If you know functional programming, where we write our function in a more modular and composable way, and basically then subscribe to the data so all listeners get notified. There are various ways to do that. So basically observable is basically observer pattern. In short, it basically provides you a nicer API to deal with complex scenarios. For example, if you want to apply, for example, the same code which you are writing, for example, something you are getting data from your HTTP API, and then you are basically applying some sort of operator and then filter and all these things. The same code, if you try to write in a JavaScript by using plain way of writing the code, you will see that there will be a lot of verbose code. So basically, in short, Rx, this observable or RxJS library in its own simplify this paradigm. It provides us reusable functional based API so that we can write our code in a clean way. And it's a functional programming concept, means we should try to use as much as a functional programming so that our function will be sort of a pure function and it shouldn't do a lot of thing. So the concept is this. You can achieve the same thing using other stuff also, but when observable is simplifying your life, then why to go for other places? So the idea is this, to introduce observable in AngularJS. Hopefully that answers your question. Okay, Vinay actually said I have a problem in code which is not running. If I provide my GitHub URL, can you help me? Yeah, sure, I can. You can just post. So where you are providing me the GitHub URL, I think please don't provide here, because here I'm basically to answer, to provide a quick solution, rather than if I particularly go to URL, then it will be quite time consuming for other guys. So I think right way is to, I think, post your whatever, if you have quite a verbose query or it requires a bit of time, so you can post it to the advisor portal, and there I can look into that, and obviously I will answer there. You will get the response. Or you can ask advisor to schedule a one-on-one meeting with me if you're still not able to solve that. So I'm moving to next question. Angular 8 is the new version in the market, but in this course you guys are teaching Angular 4. Will it impact our possibility of getting job? No, not at all. If you see, the change between Angular 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 is not that drastic, frankly speaking. If you use Angular 1, the old Angular 1, and then Angular 2, that change was pretty drastic, because old Angular 1 was written using ES5 API, and obviously the change was pretty drastic. It is sort of a learning new framework. But I think we are learning Angular 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's not a pain. I think just minimal API changes is there. I think it will not impact your job and all these things. It is not bringing a huge amount of change. So yeah, it's okay. Can you give some explanation on media queries? So Anuja has asked the question on media queries. Yeah, Anuja, so basically media query is something to make your site responsive. So for example, if you're not using any sort of framework, for example, Bootstrap out of box, give this media queries, give this responsiveness by attaching this built-in classes of Bootstrap, you can achieve the responsiveness. But if you want to write your own custom media queries behind the scene, it basically applies the media queries at runtime. But if you want to do this media queries by your own, I think there are syntax available, breakpoints available. For example, something like this, @media, and you can specify max width or min width on which you want to apply particular CSS. So that, for example, I think I can give you a very short and concise answer. For example, if you have a site, it is basically a two-column site. Means in one column, it is showing one text box. In another column, it is showing another text box. So what you want to do on mobile, you want to stack those one over each other. So for this, you can write a media query, something like this, @media. And I think mobile device width is something. If width is something 568, then do this thing. Means then basically pull my, apply that class, pull that content beneath the first content. So you can do it by applying a flex item, or you can do it by applying a some sort of margin of floating it out if you want to do it in an old way. So media query is just to make your site responsive, in short. Okay, so any more questions, guys? Any more question which you guys want to ask? So there's a question from, what the name is? From Jasprit. He is facing an issue while connecting with MongoDB running on EC2 instance. So can you please elaborate a bit what sort of issue you are getting? Basically, you might be doing something wrong. I think connection shouldn't be an issue, but if you can elaborate a bit, I might help you in that. Couldn't connect to the server. Okay, I think this line is an issue, I think. As I can see, if you are trying to connect to the EC2 instance, I think, so where your MongoDB server is running, I think I'm assuming your MongoDB server is running somewhere on EC2 instance or somewhere on cloud, right? If that's the case, then this is not the URL. You should find the right URL for that. This is your local host IP. This is basically assuming that you have hosted your MongoDB on your local server and it is running on this port. And you are trying to connect something on the EC2 to your local host. That's not possible. Either move your MongoDB to some cloud provider and get the IP, then try to connect. This way, I think you can only run the code if you have both your connection stuff and your Mongo server on the same machine. But so do you need to reinstall it? Do I need to reinstall? So you have installed the MongoDB on your local machine or on EC2 instance? Is MongoDB on your cloud or is on your local machine? See, if your MongoDB is on your local machine and the code which you are MongoDB on cloud. Okay, so please ask for right IP. This is not the right IP. You should have something. I think cloud in MongoDB setting, you can find the IP somewhere. There will be mentioned that this is the IP to connect to MongoDB. This is not the right IP because this is your local host. It means that you are running MongoDB on your cloud, on your local environment, and you can't connect something from cloud to your local environment. That's not the direct way. So you need to find the right endpoint. This is not the right endpoint. Just search on the MongoDB panel and I think see there, you can easily find some sort of connection string there. And this is something that is something which you have to use in your application. So hope this answers your question. This is not, because this I will advise the projects. So Ashwini has a question, will these projects give knowledge on real-time industry projects? Yeah, of course. I think if you see the projects which are provided by edWisor, I think they are sort of a projects which are done by big players in the market. Like a lot of big companies do the project in the same way which they do. For example, the way I think you also have to do authentication, authorization, build a server, create an API, obviously create a client in Angular, and then connect to backend if you're doing complete end-to-end application. So yeah, I think if you're following the step properly and doing it in right way, I think you are in a way getting a real-time project experience. So yeah, it's fruitful and worthful all. So yeah, you do it, but the thing is that you should do it in the right way. It's not that just you are just copy pasting and just not thinking about it. Think about it properly, do it in a nice way, learn it, try to ask as many questions as you want, Google it. I think Google is your best friend and it's your best teacher. It can answer a lot of queries, and if it's still not clear, you can come to your mentor or whatever sessions you have there, you can ask, or you can reach to advisor there, you can post your queries. So yeah, I think the sessions which they are giving basically resembles what we are having in the market. So yeah, it's worthful. So just Jaspreet, as the MongoDB panel on AWS dashboard. Yeah, you're right. Basically, I think I'm assuming you're hosting MongoDB somewhere on AWS cloud, right? So there you can see somewhere there will be a connection string, because I think search over the net how to get MongoDB connection string in AWS or on EC2 somewhere where you're hosting this stuff. I think there you can get documentation how to find the connection string and connect to your machine. So Shubham has posted one query. I had to format for navbar. One navbar is for 9 non-sign-in pages. Okay. And another one for signed-in pages. I put one style at shell page. I put one style shell page. Then I have to override and put second style after logging. I put one style at shell page. Shubham. So basically. So your question is something like this, if I'm getting it right. You have a navbar, there is a sign-in page, there's one navbar which is for sign-in page, and there is one navbar which is for normal dashboard sort of page, sorry. So your question is that, when you log into application, how to switch between those navbar, right? If I'm getting your question. So there is no need to change the styling. I think you can basically change the, I think you are using Angular for that, if I'm not wrong. You are using Angular or some sort of framework for this. So yeah, so if you're using some sort of framework, nav is your component. Navbar is your component. Yeah, okay, right. So nav is your component. So one is signed nav, something like this, signed navbar component, and another one is something called dashboard nav component, something like that, I'm assuming. So basically what do you have to do on the basis of, I think there will be some service where you will be tracking that whether you are logged in into application or you are not logged into application. So basically in services, you have that property is logged in, something like that. So based on that, you can write your logic in your header that if you are is logged in, then show that navbar stuff, logged in nav. If you're logged in, show the dashboard navbar. If you're not logged in, show the navbar. I think this is the way to go. So try to see this thing in terms of components. So you have two component on basis of certain action, you change some property, and as that property changes, Angular re-triggers, it basically evaluates the condition and it sees that which components to render. So I think this is the way to go. Hopefully that answers your question. So like that way on every template, I need to write the code. No, I think every step. And just so basically header will component header applicants are using and logged in changes, it automatically re-render this header. So this stuff, has the navbar stuff for signed in page and navbar stuff a navbar component for the non-signed in page, and you have to decide based on the service. So as the service property changes, you have to render those components. You can use a ternary statement. For example, if it's logged in, not ternary, you can use if else also. If is logged in, inject the service and then basically get the logged in property, and on that basis just destructure those things. So I hope this answers your question. Just try it out. If it doesn't work out, I think we can sync at other time also, but I think this is a way you should approach. Just think in that way that this is a component. Don't think Angular is basically a set of components. So whatever you are putting, it's a set of component, and what are you making? Basically, if you are putting two or three component, then it is called as a composed component, right? So think in terms of component. Every element or every layout on your page is a component. So that will make your life easier, and you will understand it in the right way, that how to basically, when you want to communicate between things, you have services. When you want to do re-rendering, you can just change the property this. And obviously, I'm assuming you are not using that built-in. You are not changing the strategy and all that. You are relying on built-in Angular re-rendering stuff. So I think this should work. So I think there was a question from Megharai which I missed. So the question was, can you please explain the inheritance in case of CSS? Okay. So what happens in CSS? So CSS is, as you know, that it's a cascading style sheet. So basically what happens, there are certain properties which every element inherits, which some element inherits. For example, there is a color property. If you have given the color property on the base div, parent div, then what happens, those color property will get automatically inherited by all the child divs or whatever inner element of that parent div. So that's the inheritance in CSS. Obviously this doesn't follow with every part of CSS, but with some property it follows. For example, there's a color property, and then there is font size, font weight, if I'm not wrong, but color property is for sure. And the other property, but there are certain property which doesn't do inheritance, like display property doesn't do inheritance. For example, if you put a display block on a parent div, it will not apply on child div, because that doesn't make any sense. So there are certain properties which are inheritable, like color, font size, font weight, and the others also. You can search over the net for this, all the properties which basically by which you can do the inheritance in CSS. Shell page means app.component.html page, right? No, I'm not sure of what shell page you are asking. Ashwini asked question. Has asked the question that shell page means app.component.html. I'm not sure, Ashwin, that how you are basically naming the component, so I can't answer this. So there's a question, what shell page in Angular? Yeah, it is same. Kindly fill in the form. I think so Ashwini is asking question from Shubham, I think. So yeah, I think Ashwini, I think as Shubham is answering the question. I think it depends how you have named the component. I'm not sure of how you have named those components. Maybe you are naming in a same way. So yeah, you can sync up, because in naming, I can't help that much. So any more thing from you guys? Yeah, this is a question from Megha Rai. So if you write the code like font size 10 pixel, yeah. So later in the code, we can add another element as well. Yeah, yeah. If this property is inheritable, which I'm assuming it is, then what happens? Then, for example, there is a div. Okay, on that div, you have applied certain font size. Then what happens? All the child element of that div automatically get that font size. Right? So assuming you got my answer, you understand? On creating engine, you have the shell page gets created like that with the same. Oh, okay. Okay, I haven't tried that, so I'm not sure of that. I will look into that. I don't know about, because I haven't tried engine new for a I think quite a, now it's been a, quite a time since I have used ng new app. So yeah, I will look into that, what that shell page is. I think earlier the structure was something like this: app.component.html, app.component.ts, and app.module.ts, and then you're going to start putting a feature into that main module and something like this. So yeah, maybe and they might have changed the structure. Not sure of that. Yeah, please ask. So this is one question from Megha Rai on JS. I think she is posting it. So, sir, there is this entire program, it shows logical error. So, Megha, where is your program? And I think, please ask the concise question. If the question is too big, then it will be difficult for me to answer at this moment of time. So, can you ask in a short what you want to do? Because seeing the entire question, entire code, I think it will be difficult for me in one go. So, just ask me a concise question here, so that I can answer it in the right way and you also understand it. So there is a question from Shubham. While developing, which is more better approach, first to develop backend or first front end? I think it's immaterial. I think basically generally what happens if you go in a company, what happens, you get a separate backend team, you get a separate front end team. So they do their own development, and till backend get ready, front end mocks the data, basically build their front end using the mock data. So it's immaterial. You can develop anything first. If you are using a full stack development, it depends what your manager or whomever you have to report has asked you what to do, what to develop first. So it's immaterial. assume there's one image in other site, we have to bring it to our estimate page. How can we achieve that? I think you can just give the source to that URL where you are hosting that image. For example, there is some domain xyz.com, and there you are having that image xyz.com/images/b.jpg, image/b.jpg in xyz.com, and now you want to bring it into your example.com. So basically you can do something like this: image src equal to in your example.com, image src equal to xyz.com/image/whatever name of that image.jpg. So you can do bring that image into your site by this way. Let me post the syntax also. If Shubham, Ashwini, I think Ashwini has asked this. Ashwini. Okay, so there's a question from Mega. JS function to calculate age that makes that takes birthday in the format DD MMYY and returns your age. Okay, so do you want me to help in the logic of this? I think for logic, I think you should do. If you are facing any error in your program, I might help you, but logic you should apply by yourself. If you are getting any syntax error, you can ask me. If you just post me the syntax error, what you are getting. But I will not make you understand the logic of this. This you have to derive by yourself. That's how you will build your logic. No, I think it's not mandatory to have constructor in classes. By default, compiler or interpreter will automatically add a constructor for you. So if you haven't given a constructor, automatically at compile time or build time at runtime, compiler will add that constructor. For example, you are deriving something from your base class. For example, you have a class A, you have a class B, and then what you want to do, you want to basically set some properties of base class also. Then in that case, I think constructor is necessary in case of derived class, because you want to set some properties of base class. But as such, if there is no need to set the property of base class, then there's no need to basically call the constructor into your class. However, compiler or interpreter or whatever transpiler your application is having, it will automatically add that constructor for you behind the scene, default constructor. Meghna, can you post your function? So what sort of error you are getting? Or what sort of code you have written and what sort of error you are getting? Then I might help you in that. Guys, I'm here for 10 more minutes. I think in that, if you want whatever questions you want to ask, you can ask, and then I have to leave. So I'm here for 10 more minutes. So there's a question from Ashwini. How can we receive a date as input from the user in the form of DD MMYY? So if you are using some built-in date picker, built-in date picker component, I think it automatically give you the date in some predefined format, whatever format you have mentioned there. But if you are, if you need to do this from scratch, what you can do, you can have done for days, one drop down for month, and one drop down from year. And then what you can do, as you select any one value from, for example, you select January as month, you select one as day, and you select 1990 as year, then you just need to combine those with the slashes and store in a variable. This is how you can get this is one way to get that. Yeah, if you are using some sort of date picker, and then you'll automatically get that because that date picker has those APIs available. It automatically give you that date in this format. But there's one other way also, which I told you earlier. You can have three separate drop downs, just choose their value and concatenate them with the slashes. So that's these are the two ways. So Ashwini, is that answered your question or? Okay. So there's a question from Shubham. What is a UTC in date time? Yeah. So basically what happens, date time is a very complicated day. See what happens if it is happening. It is here, I think 8:40. And today is, I think, 7th of September. But in Canada, what is happening? It is basically 9 in the morning and 7th September. So basically, UTC is a basically a generic way to store a date, basically universal time. So what happens? We should store our date time in a UTC format on backend. And then when that date basically comes to the client, and since we are the client, means our machine is a client, what happens, we are in our own time zone. For example, if I am sitting here, I am in an India time zone, I have stored my date in a UTC time zone, and if I get the date, that UTC date will automatically get converted to my IST date, right? If suppose you have stored that date in a wrong format, not in a UTC format, for example, you have stored date. For example, I save my date according to my machine. For example, if it is currently happening 8:30, 7 September 8:30, and I have stored this date in the same way, not in a UTC way, in this same, in my local way, into DB. Now, next time, suppose some Canada user is reading my date, right? So for him, the wrong date will get appeared. Because that date which is stored into the DB is stored according to my local, not to the generic UTC time. So UTC is a universal time, and when we bring that universal time to any machine, that time will get basically converted to according to user's local machine. So I think hopefully you got my point of it. It's not that straightforward to make you understand UTC. It's a universal time. There is a way to store a universal. There's a concept called ISO date time, basically, which simplifies that it's a UTC timestamp. And there are ways you can know that this is the UTC timestamp by, if you see the date time, something like this, dd/yy/mm/dd, and then at last you note a Z prefix, Z suffix. It means that it's a ISO date time, and it signifies it's a UTC. So ISO is a representation of UTC timestamp. You got my point? So generally we should store our date time in a UTC format on server, so that whenever it comes to anyone's machine, it signifies the right time on their machine. Hopefully that answers your question. It's not that straightforward to make you understand UTC. Please read more about UTC on net also. Yeah, this question from Ashwini, why right? Yeah, if I'm getting you, you are right. What is the UTC and date time? Okay. So there was a question from Megha Rai. Okay, she has posted the code. Okay, so Megha, can you please tell me what error you are getting? Because the way I'm seeing the code, I think I can't understand it, what you have written. So what error you are getting? Function calculated. So basically you are taking the argument where today equal to new date, where birth date, DOB. Okay, so what this DOB, I think you are getting the error at this DOB, because this DOB, I can't see this DOB, where this DOB is coming from in this function. Is this somewhere defined outside of this function? What this DOB is? So there's a question from Megha Rai. Megha, in your birth date, you are passing where birth date a function. I think this syntax is wrong. I think. Megha, this code base you have written is wrong. This line is wrong. This is not the correct syntax. If I'm seeing it right, you have written something like this. Let me post to Megha. Megha, you have written something like this. This is wrong syntax. It should be something like this, if I'm right. Birth date, and obviously pass something which is available in the scope. Something like this. If you are doing where birth and calling birth date function, so this should error out. So syntactically it's not right what you are doing. Yeah, sure. Please try that. Learn the basic of functions. I think the way you are writing the function is, it's clear that you are pretty new to that. So first learn how to write a function and how to arrange variables and proceed to the logic stuff. Because no matter how good your logic, if you're not following the right construct, your program will break out. So first learn how to write a proper function. Means how to call a function, how to pass an argument to that function. So any more questions, guys? I think just 3 minutes and then I will be done. Okay. So there's a question from, I think, Ashwini, if I'm not wrong. Yeah. So basically, Ashwini is asking the use of rest and spread params. So basically these are new construct available, which came into this, as this new ESX library came into the picture. So basically it's a sweeter way to basically, construct and deconstruct, the things. For example, how shall I make you understand this? Mm-hmm. So something like this. Uh-huh. You can do something like this. For example, you have a function, okay, and you are passing, for example, you want to pass multiple argument to that function. Earlier in ES5, there was a keyword argument through which basically at random arguments we are getting. But with this new AP syntax, what we can do, for example, I want to pass multiple numbers. For example, I have function add and I'm calling add. And in add, I am passing 1, 2, 3, 4, but I haven't defined those four arguments for my function add. Add is just having one spread operator B. So it automatically collects your those four values into an array. And now you just have to loop through those array and basically sum those value and return the result. So this is one use case which I think you can use. And there are other use case also. For example, if you have done destructuring and all that,